You know that wonderful space right outside your door? Well, maybe one thing you haven't thought about is how it is directly connected to one of our wonderful creeks and rivers in Tennessee. And today we're going to talk about how what you do affects not just what you see outside, but all of our fun and the whole environment, in fact. So we're going to talk to Ryan Jackwood from the Harpeth Conservancy about something near and dear to your heart, right?
Absolutely. So really, the river is kind of connected through what we call a watershed. And the watershed is going to be all the land that actually, when it rains, that water drains to our river. And so how we take care of our land, our yards, is really going to impact the water quality that we see in our rivers, because all of that washout is eventually going to get there.
Aha, those storm drains,
those storm ditches.
Now it all starts to make a lot of sense. Well, let's think about that, because, you know, we've all seen a lot about your typical lawn maintenance, which involves a lot of chemicals. Is that really necessary?
No. We really try to discourage using fertilizer. Fertilizer contains what we would consider NPK, and that's nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. And yes, those are the kind of building blocks of plant life, but when they're not used up on the land, they make it to our river, and that's where we see excess algae growing, and we can get a lot of problems in our rivers. In addition to that, most of the soils in Middle Tennessee are already inundated with phosphorus. And so when you're adding more fertilizer to that, you're just adding excess that's kind of being useless. So we really kind of discourage using fertilizer, and we also really encourage doing soil tests on your lawn, because that's gonna help you develop a diet for your lawn, and that makes it much healthier than just throwing a bunch of fertilizer out there and hoping for the best. I think we also really kind of want to change the mindset a little bit about having this like very uniform green lawn that is, you know, one species of grass and nothing else is growing there. It's okay to have a little diversity and to have some native plants and stuff, and so instead of worrying about a herbicide that's, you know, you're targeting, trying to kill those things, you know, maybe it's okay to let some of them grow.
All right. So what are some of the benefits of letting my yard go a little bit wild? I mean, I still want it sort of green, but
sure,
if I let it go a little wild?
Diversity is one of the things that we really preach in kind of having a natural habitat. And so having different types of plants and different species of plants really kind of, they make the soil healthier. They make the whole kind of, we could call it your yard environment, you know, it's going to make it those things a lot healthier and provide plants and flowers for pollinators and bees. And that's going to help, you know, with the, you know, insect life and with just every, you know, the environment in general.
Well, it sounds like a real change in mindset here.
It can be. Small steps, and, you know, maybe it's just a little landscaping thing, or maybe it's just, you know, a little thing that you have in front of your yard that it's, you know, we add some diversity to, but it's, it can certainly be a good thing.
Well, you know, sometimes in the spring I look out in my yard and I see all these beautiful violets and the yellow and other colors, and I go up and realize there are dandelions and other things. And it sort of makes me happy, though.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's nice that those things oftentimes will just come in naturally.
What about other plants that I choose? Are there really great plants that I can choose for being, especially if I'm near a river or something?
We really would encourage native grasses, particularly native grasses kind of on the buffer between your yard and maybe you live next to a river. They do really great at basically picking up any excess nutrients that we want to maybe prevent from getting into our waterways, and because since they grow really fast. So that would be some of them. I think there's a lot of, you know, woody vegetation that would also work well, that would, you know, and we just kind of really, our big thing is trying to stay native as best as we can.
All right, so native plants make a lot of sense. I imagine you don't want anything really invasive in there. So one other thing that I have noticed is this right here with all this erosion going down into the river. This looks like a problem to me.
Yeah, so this would be one of the things that we see erosion all over the place, and we would really want to keep more of a buffer here. And if you notice, you know, we see some trees around here, and we like to think that we at least want 3 trees in width from the river as a good kind of buffer and way to kind of prevent the soil from falling into the river and flowing downstream and you know, getting spots like this.
Well, I have heard that our soil sediment is the biggest pollutant in our rivers.
It's one of the biggest, absolutely. I think nutrients are up there as well, nutrients and bacteria, but certainly sediment. And One of the reasons that is, those three are kind of tied together because both nutrients and bacteria are attached to sediment. So when we lose sediment, oftentimes we're losing those things too into the river.
It's all stuff to be aware of. Now, for my neighbors that like to really mow a lot, because they're fertilizing a lot, so they're mowing a lot, and so it drives me crazy when they blow all their grass clippings and leaves into the road.
Yes, we would really encourage that you can actually leave the grass clippings on your yard after you mow, and it acts as kind of like a natural fertilizer. They'll break down, they'll get back into the soil, so you're kind of recycling the, you know, the nutrients that you already have on your yard. And that's really great. Blowing it into the road is then gonna wash down to the road into a storm drain and then show up in the river, and then that's really not great either for our river health and wildlife.
Other things that homeowners do, let me see here. Working on their cars really close to a storm drain. I think I'm getting the feeling here that none of this is going to go well.
Yeah, I mean, we obviously would want to try to prevent, you know, as much pollution going into the storm drains as we can. I mean, those essentially can go right to the river. And so, you know, if you're using chemicals on your car, if, you know, a lot of that soap, you know, we don't want to see, you know, soap oftentimes has phosphorus in it. And so that phosphorus is one of the nutrients that's getting into our rivers and causing problems. So, you know, if you've got to wash your car, maybe no phosphate soaps might be the way to go. But yeah, that can be problematic as well.
So in terms of taking care of a lawn,
yes.
Now, I personally just don't like to mow very much. But I know some people like to mow a lot. So do you have any sort of really good tips for people that maybe want to be a little more natural?
Yeah, if we're talking about soil health, in general, the more we let a plant grow, it's going to put down roots farther. And so if we let the grass grow maybe an extra week and a half, then our typical kind of mowing cycle, the root structure is going to be a lot better in your yard and for the grass. And so that's going to help the soils be hardier, be healthier, and really kind of be more stable.
Well, Ryan, this has been most informative. I'm happy to know that being a little lazy with the lawn is going to help the river here. So thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you so much for having me.
So I want you to think about enjoying your wonderful rivers that we have here in Tennessee. And as you're thinking about where you might go on a river adventure, I want you to remember that the health of that river starts with you and with your front yard and everything that you do.
For inspiring garden tours, growing tips, and garden projects, visit our website at volunteergardener.org or on YouTube at the Volunteer Gardener channel and like us on Facebook.